right. I'm just going to open it up. Obviously, we're a little disappointed in what happened today, so I'll open it up for any questions.
Leader Homo, I guess I'll start with the same question I asked the speaker about the gun bill. Mm-hmm. The debate got very heated a couple times. We had to gavel it down.
Sure.
Were you surprised at the tone of the debate and your thoughts on the final vote? Because they ended up with a couple extra votes over 100.
Mm-hmm. I think it's 112. Sure. You know, I think when we were debating the bill, I said it, you know, people are very passionate about the issue in the state, and tempers run high. There seems to be a divide between communities. You know, certainly in my community, we're dealing with an extremely high amount of murders. We see things probably a little differently than some of our members that are in the rural areas. And it seems like what's happened is that, and this is probably true for everything in politics in the United States, is we've gone to the extremes, and we can't find common ground in the middle. And it's very disappointing. I think that we had at least some semblance of a safety net for these concealed carry permits before. You know, we had the minimal training. We had the sheriffs that would be the backstop to decide who and who did not get these. And so I'm obviously very disappointed. I think that what we've done is made Missouri less safe. You know, we just last year, 1,500 people were denied a permit from the Sheriff's Department. And these are the people that are in our communities that know the people in those counties and are probably one of the best judges of who should and should not be carrying a weapon. And I think that we've basically told our law enforcement community that we don't trust them. Correct.
So I guess the state would have to try to seek some waiver from them. Will the minority party be sending some letter saying don't grant that waiver?
Well, I believe that they've already said they're not going to grant a waiver, if I'm not mistaken. So I guess we just don't believe them again. I don't really have a good answer to that. So they've said they're not going to do it. I'll take them at their word.
Now, how do you see it as far as your supporters and voters?
Well, again, I will. I don't know what the winning message would be, other than the fact that we gave away another $65 million that we're going to take from our children's school system. We've got a school system in the state of Missouri that is woefully underfunded. Again, just recently, we've lowered again the dollar amount that we're supposed to be sending to our schools through the foundation formula. And so now, as they are very much aware, the only place that you can start taking large amounts of cash like that out of, to the tune of $65 million, is out of our public education system. So if they want to go back to their voters and say, don't worry, I underfunded our schools by another $65 million, that's a message that I'm happy to take back to the voters in the election in November. Well, certainly, I think this was the cart before the horse. Look, the right of the voter is not supposed to be infringed. Putting another layer of restrictions in front of the voting populace is the wrong thing to do. Courts have time and time again said that these laws are illegal, and I hope that that happens again. I hope that at some point the courts will say, if this passes in November, I think that I'm very hopeful that the courts will toss it out again. Anytime you take away someone's ability to vote, I think you make it harder on what this country is supposed to be about.
Do you intend to campaign between now and November to urge folks to vote the way you want them to?
Sure, I have been. I've been helping with the coalition already.
Those of you who are coming back in the next couple of years,
before I turn this over to Representative Beatty, I just want to say one thing, that if Representative Engler thinks it's a good idea to allow between now and the time that that bill supposedly passes to let a domestic violence offender get a firearm, then I think he shouldn't be in this body, because I think that is incredibly insensitive. It is absolutely an embarrassment to the state to say that, don't worry, only a few people will get hurt. Only a few people will get a gun that are abusing their spouse. It's absolutely ridiculous, and he shouldn't be in this body if he thinks that's an appropriate thing to say on the floor of the House.
You know, I just kind of have to reiterate what Representative Hummel said. One person in danger is too many, and we never should have passed that the way it is. As for what do we do next year, we're going to need to fix that. None of us agree with the provisions that are there now. I don't know that we'll have the ability to change that, but we definitely need to deal with those issues to make sure, we have an obligation to make sure that we are keeping our constituents safe.
On the gun bill debate, I'm in this room and I'm seeing a lot of representatives from St. Louis and Kansas City, and all the Republicans are from not St. Louis and Kansas City. Is there a way to rectify the regional divide that seems to have gripped the state, not just on this issue, but on so many other issues?
At some point, we're going to have to deal with that. When we start talking about violence and gun violence in general, you know, I'll tell a story. A few weeks ago, I drove home, and I looked in the middle of the street, and I thought, there's something in the middle of the street. When I drove up that street, there was a body in the middle of the street. I apparently had drove through just maybe a minute or two after the shooting occurred. That's close to home. And I don't know how we get them to understand that we as legislators, that our constituents are scared. We talk about our police officers and their safety. We just opened up a bill that's going to make it more unsafe for them. We talk about Black Lives Matter. We just made it open season. And they can say none of this is going to happen. It is absolutely going to happen.
I'd like to add to that in terms of, you know, gun violence actually affects our entire state. I wasn't allowed to actually speak today on the gun bill, but in the last 3 months, we've had 168 gun deaths in the entire state. These are documented from, you know, news sources. And those 168 were even outside of St. Louis and Kansas City. So there's this myth that we do not have gun deaths outside of our metropolitan areas. And gun deaths now are everything. They are suicides, they're domestic violence, they're little kids getting a hold of a weapon that now we have made it much easier, you know, again, without training or a permit. So this myth that gun violence only affects those of us that live in inner cities is completely false. And the myth that we are not in the Wild West is completely false. And I think what we're all pretty disturbed about is those gun death numbers don't mean anything to the majority party today, let alone next week. So one gun death is too many. You know, as the minority leader pointed out, that, you know, do you have to see a body in your neighborhood for you to be affected? We're all affected. And this tells you today that the gun lobby has a stranglehold over the majority party in this building, and they don't care. They don't care what the gun deaths are going to be or are now.
Thank you.
Thank you.